My name is Rick Renner, and today I'm in the ancient city of Laodicea, a big, wealthy city right in the heart of the Lycus Valley, situated between Colossae and Hierapolis. This was a powerful, political, rich banking center of the Lycus Valley during the times of the New Testament. You can see the richness of the city when you walk through these ruins and look at the carved reliefs on the statues, the monuments. It is just amazing. You can see the chariot ruts where a lot of chariots were coming and going. And in this city, there are thousands of ancient shops where people shopped. This was simply a very rich city. And in this city, there was also a church. We know that because Christ addressed them in Revelation chapter 3, verse 14, when he said, "Unto the angel of the church of Laodicea." Here we are. This is Laodicea. There was a church here. But by the time we come to the end of the first century, when Christ was speaking to the churches here in the Roman province of Asia, this church had a serious problem. We know that because in Revelation 3:20, Jesus says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock." Christ was on the outside of this church. And Christ was knocking on the door saying, "Open the door, open the door." In fact, when the Greek says, "I stand at the door and knock," the Greek actually says, "I stand at the door pounding, pounding." He was begging to be readmitted to the church. Wow. We don't want Jesus to stand on the outside of the church. We want him to have entrance to the church and to feel comfortable inside the church. I'm sure there are many churches today that Jesus is knocking on the door saying, "Please, will you open the door? I want to come back into my church." That is exactly what Christ was saying to the church here in Laodicea. And today, we're going to begin studying Christ's message to the church in Laodicea.
Stay tuned for a teaching you can trust, a message that will inspire, strengthen, and equip you with vital insight and understanding from the Word of God. Here's Rick.
Welcome to today's program. I cannot begin to tell you how happy I am to be sitting here and to be able to talk with you today. I feel like I'm the most blessed person in the world that God allows me to bring you the teaching of the Bible. And thank you for turning on your device and letting me come right into your space today. Thank you so much for this privilege. And as we get started, I want to tell you that if you need prayer, please call us. Call us right now. We're waiting for your call. And when you call, you're going to meet the most wonderful, warm voice on the other end of that line, just waiting to talk to you. We're waiting to pray for you. We believe that is part of our ministry. And when you call us, we will really sincerely pray with you and believe for God to do something about whatever it is that's concerning your heart right now. So call us or send us an email. When your email shows up in our inbox, we'll immediately go to prayer. And I want to remind you that right now we're offering you my brand new series. Please get this one. It's called Christ's Message to Laodicea. It's 10 parts. It comes in multiple formats. This teaching is so jam-packed with Greek words and history and points and principles. Really understanding the message which Jesus spoke to the Laodiceans, which he's still speaking to us today. For example, Jesus said, "Because you're neither cold nor hot, I'm going to spew you out of my mouth." What in the world does that mean? Well, we need to know. That is one of the things that I cover in this remarkable series. So order your copy today. And it comes with a study guide. The study guide is just beautiful. It is so full of information. And when you have the study guide and the series together, it really enforces what you're seeing or what you're hearing. So I want to advise you to order your copy today. And we're also offering you right now my mammoth books. One is called A Light in Darkness. This deals with the seven messages in the book of Revelation. And we're offering you the follow-up book, which is called No Room for a Compromise. And let me tell you, we have a limited number of No Room for Compromise. So if you're planning to order your copy, you need to do it as quick as possible. But today we're offering you A Light in Darkness, No Room for Compromise. These really are treasures, and they're filled with photographs. The photography is just magnificent. I wish I could just sit by you right now and open these books and show you. This is all work that my own team did. We went to Turkey. We went to all of these sites. We did all of this study ourselves. This is like an encyclopedia about the early church. It will explain so many things to you about why Christians suffered, why they were persecuted, where did Christians meet for church, and we deal with the words of Jesus in the book of Revelation. Anyway, both of these are treasures, and I know that you're going to want to get your copy. And if you're not a partner, please pray about joining us as a member of our partner family. You know, it's not about money. Of course, it takes money to do this, and a partner is somebody who regularly financially supports our ministry. You can become a partner by going online or by calling us right now. But really, it's about doing something together. Together, we can impact a lot of lives. If I do it by myself or you try to do it by yourself, we won't get very far. But when we combine our resources and we combine our effort together, we can do something that really affects a lot of people. People are really crying for somebody to bring them the verse-by-verse teaching of the Bible. And when you become a partner, you help us take that teaching to them. If you're already a partner, I want to say thank you, partner. You're really a part of our family. We thank God for you. We really pray for you. But for those who become a partner, we send you a package of books as our way of saying welcome to the partner family. We send you my book called Life in the Combat Zone. We send you this, not because we're predicting a combat zone. You're probably already in one. You need to know how to survive it. That's why the subtitle says, How to Survive, Thrive, and Overcome in the Midst of Difficult Situations. And this book is dedicated to partners, and that's why we send it to partners, along with Denise's book, which is small but is really powerful. It's called The Gift of Forgiveness. Anyway, when you become a partner, we immediately send those to you as our way of saying welcome to our partner family. But today we're going to begin our study in Revelation chapter 3, where we're going to see Jesus' message to the church in Laodicea. Now, today and this week, we're wrapping up this series. We've already seen what Jesus had to say to the previous six churches. We saw what Jesus had to say to the amazing church that was located in the city of Ephesus. The church of Ephesus was a church that had lost their first love. We've already covered that. Then we moved to the church of Smyrna. The church of Smyrna was a church that was suffering, but Jesus held out hope for them, as he does to everyone that's in any difficult situation. Then we moved to the city of Pergamum, and we saw that in Pergamum there was a terrible false doctrine, which Jesus compared to the doctrine of Balaam. It was seducing God's people. And then from there, we moved to Thyatira, and we saw that in Thyatira, there was a woman, a false prophetess in the church, possibly the pastor's wife, who was seducing the church also with false doctrine. Her name was Jezebel. And we find that Jesus gave her space to repent, but she did not take the opportunity. And Jesus had some very rough things to say to her and to those who participated with her. Then we went to Sardis, and we saw that Sardis was a legendary city with a legendary church, a church that had a great beginning. But by the time that we come to the book of Revelation, it had a name that it was alive, but in fact it was dead. Then we came to the city of Philadelphia, where there was a church that had a great opportunity. And that's why Jesus said to them, I've placed before you an open door. It was the church with the great missionary opportunity. And today we come to what Jesus had to say to the church, which was in Laodicea. So let's open our Bibles. I have my Bible. I hope that you have yours. And let's go to Revelation chapter 3, verse 14, where Jesus begins his final message to the seven churches in the book of Revelation. And that final message is to the church in Laodicea. Listen to what he says. Revelation 3, verse 14. And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, These things saith the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. Verse 15. Oh, these are amazing words. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot. Why would he would they were cold or hot? It seems to be better to be lukewarm than to be cold. But Jesus said, rather than be cold or I would rather that you be cold or hot than to be what you are right now. Then he says in verse 16, So then because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. You know, I would think being lukewarm is better than being cold. So why did Jesus have something against them? Because they were lukewarm. Isn't that better than being cold? No, it's not. You're going to find out why in the next program. Verse 17, Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. Verse 18, I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. Then in verse 19, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. Verse 20, behold, here's the famous verse. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. We all use this in the invitation for the lost to be saved. But in fact, Jesus was not speaking to the lost. He was speaking to his church. And Jesus was standing on the outside of the church. He says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him and he with me. Verse 21, to him that overcometh, will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I overcame, and am set down with my Father in his throne. Verse 22, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. Do you hear how powerful and how packed are all of these verses? But we have to begin in verse 14. Where Jesus says, unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write. We have to go back to this word angel because it is repeated 7 times in the book of Revelation when Jesus addresses these churches. And Jesus never addresses the church directly. He always addresses the angel of the church. This is important. The word angel, as we've already seen, the Greek word angelos, depicts a human messenger or an angel, one sent on a special mission, one dispatched to perform a specific assignment. It could describe a delegate or a dignitary. And here it is used to describe the role of a pastor who is a messenger sent from God, which means your pastor does not belong to you. He's there to serve you, but your pastor belongs to the Lord. He was sent, he was dispatched, he is heaven's delegate. He is heaven's dignitary. And in all 7 of these cases, when Jesus wants to address the church, first he speaks to the messenger. He speaks to the pastor, which tells us Jesus respects authority and never bypasses authority that he has set in place. The first ear to hear these commendations and these rebukes was the pastor. And it was his job to internalize everything he heard from Jesus. And once he had internalized it, really understood it, then he was to deliver it to the church in the power of the Holy Spirit. That is the pastor's primary function. But wait, it goes on to say to the angel of the church of the Laodiceans. The word church is so marvelous, and this is the last time we're going to cover this in this series. The word church, a very renowned word in the Greek world, is the Greek word ekklesia. It's a compound of 2 words. The word ek means out. The word klesia is from the word kaleo, which means to call. When you compound the 2 words together, ekklesia from ek and kaleo means to call out, to summon forth. And I'm going to read to you from my notes. It is a called, separated assembly, a prestigious group of distinguished citizens who determined laws, debated public policy, formulated new policies, argued and ruled in judicial matters, elected chief magistrates, and decided who should be banished. These were people with real power who were members of the ecclesia. And the first ecclesia we know of, this really was a very political word which was used in the city of Athens. In fact, today, if you go to Athens, there's a hill near the Acropolis that you can visit. Few people go there, but it's there, and it's very important because that was the first ecclesia. It was not a religious body. It was a political body of 6,000 citizens who were summoned forth from Athens. And together as a group, they ruled, they made decisions, they did worship together. They had a leader called the Kerux. It's where we get the word for a preacher. All of that is where we get the word for the church, which is called the ecclesia. It was a body that was called out, called for, selected, and assembled to make decisions. But for us, the church, we are a called out body of believers who've been selected to be God's representatives in every town, every city, every state, every nation. We are God's people called to make decisions that affect the atmosphere of a region. That's who we are. We're not just people hiding in a building on the corner trying to get through life. We have been invested with spiritual authority to change the atmosphere of our different locations. That's who we are. We are God's called out, distinguished people. But this verse says to the angel of the church of the Laodiceans. We have to look at the word Laodicea. What do we know about Laodicea? Well, we know a lot. We know the original name of this city was Diospolis, which means the city of Zeus. That was the most ancient name of this city. But later on, Antiochus II came along, and he built on top of that ancient city and renamed it after his wife, whose name was Laodice. And that's why it's called Laodicea. It was located right in the very middle of the Lycus Valley on a hill. It was 11 miles from Hierapolis. It was 10 miles from Colossae. In fact, if you're in Laodicea on a good day with a clear view, you can see Hierapolis 11 miles away, and you can easily look over to the hill where Colossae was built 10 miles away. Hierapolis was a military city, a fabulous city. A church was there, a church which had been launched by believers from Colossae. But it was a military center, and it was especially known for its mineral hot springs. In fact, today, if you visit the city of Laodicea, those mineral hot springs are still there. They are simply fabulous. But that was Hierapolis. Colossae, which was 10 miles away, was noted for its cool, refreshing waters, and it was a resort town. The waters came down from the top of the mountain, and people went there to be refreshed when the weather was hot. So you had cold water on one side, you had hot water on the other side, and in the middle on a hill was the city of Laodicea, which was fabulously rich, and it was nestled among many rich cities, but this was the richest of all the cities. It was a banking center. It was a center for the textile industry. We know that there was a very famous medical school there which specifically dealt with eye problems, and they had created an eye powder called Phrygian powder, which they believed, and it was true, proven to be true, it had the ability to heal eyes that were sick. All of this is very important as we continue to see what Jesus had to say to the church in Laodicea. But Laodicea was simply fabulously rich, rich beyond belief. Even today, when you go there and you look at the ruins in the city of Laodicea, two theaters. Can you imagine? Most cities had one. It had a stadium so massive it could accommodate up to 60,000 people. Most big cities, maximum, had two markets. Laodicea had four, and it seems they had around 4,500 shops. And they had flowing cold water and warm water. It was a city like none others. And in the Lycus Valley, this was the richest, the most affluent of all of the cities. But when you come to Revelation 3, verse 14, Jesus continues and he says, "Unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things saith the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God." In this verse, Jesus describes himself four times as being in a very unique category, and no one else is in this category with him. Jesus says he is the Amen, he is the witness, he is the faithful, he is the true, and in every one of these cases, there is in Greek what we call a definite article, which elevates Jesus into a category by himself. No one else is in this category. For example, the Bible says he is the Amen. The word ho in Greek is a definite article connected to the word amen. The word amen means that which is faithful, firm, sure, most assuredly, emphatic, final, the final word. But because it has a definite article, it means Jesus is the faithful above all else. No one else is in this category of faithfulness. He is the final word. There's no word after his. He is the amen. But then it goes on to say he is the witness. Now, the Greek sentence structure is a little different. It literally says he is the witness, again, with a definite article, the word ho and the word martus. That word ho means he is the one. No other one else is in this category. The word witness is the Greek word martus. It's where we get the word for a martyr. That's very important. And listen to what this word witness really means, the Greek word martus. It depicts one who is summoned to testify in a court of law. Legal witnesses, oh, this is so important, were only allowed to speak what was personally known to be true, And this word witness, the Greek word martyr, is connected to the idea of suffering, because if one was called to be a witness, he was required to be faithful to the truth regardless of possible retribution that might be carried out against him or by those who opposed him or wanted to suppress his testimony. To be a martus, a witness, required the highest level of integrity and commitment, as well as a willingness to sacrifice oneself or his status to uphold the truth. And the Bible says Jesus is not just a witness, he is the witness. There's a definite article. No one has more integrity than Jesus. Jesus set the example of bravery for all of us. He is the witness. He stood by the truth. Regardless of what price he had to pay, Jesus upheld the truth. He is the witness in a category by himself above all other witnesses. So he is the final word. He is the supreme witness. But wait, it goes on to say, he is faithful. And in Greek, again, there is a definite article. It says ho pistis. That word ho is a definite article, which means the word faithful. It means he is the faithful one. There is none others like him. And in fact, the word faithful means one that is faithful, one that is reliable, one that's proven to be true, one that is dependable, totally trustworthy. So you could actually translate the one who is faithful, the one who is most trustworthy above all others. But then it goes on to say he is the true witness. The word true, again, has a definite article, is the Greek phrase ho alethinos. Alethinos means true, but it's preceded by a definite article, ho. He is the truth. He's not just a truth. This definite article means Jesus is the truth. He is the only truth. And the word alethinos could be translated the one who's true, real, bona fide, the one who's genuine, indisputable, and authentic. And when you translate all of this together, it could be translated, these things saith he who is the witness, the faithful and the reliable one who is absolutely trustworthy, the one who is absolutely true and indisputable. And then it goes on to say he is the beginning of the creation of God. Again, in Greek, we have a definite article. He's not a beginning. Jesus is the beginning. That definite article means he is the only one that has this name, this title, this category. He is the beginning. The word beginning, the Greek word arche, which describes the initial starting point. He is the one who started it all. And then it goes on to say the beginning, the originator of the creation of God. That word creation from the Greek word katizo, which means to create something out of nothing. This all agrees with John chapter 1, verse 3, where John writes, all things were made by him, and without him was nothing made that was made. Or Colossians chapter 1, verse 16 and 17, where Paul says, everything was made by Jesus, and even today he is the power that's holding everything together, which means Jesus himself was the creator. He was the originator. He was the starting point that created everything out of nothing. This is who we are serving. Jesus, who is the faithful one. He is the amen. He is the final word. Jesus is the truth above all of the truths. He is the supreme witness. He is the one that has the final say-so. And he was in the beginning. He was the originator of everything that we see. This is the Jesus whom we serve. We're out of time, but when we come back in the next program, we're going to see what the amen had to say to this church. Jesus was going to give the final word to the church of the Laodiceans. We're out of time, but I'll be back in just a moment, and I'm going to pray for you.
Has your fire for God waned or dwindled? Would you like to get your flame back again? In Christ's message to Laodicea, Rick Renner will show you how to once again become spiritually strong, vibrant, and healthy. This series, full of historical insights and on-site filming in Laodicea, will help you get back on track spiritually. Jesus is knocking at the door of your heart, but you'll find that only you can open the door. In this 10-part series, you'll learn what the Bible means when it says someone is spiritually cold or spiritually hot, why Jesus is standing at the door of your heart knocking. Available in digital or physical format, starting at just $20, Christ's message to Laodicea will teach you how to get unstuck spiritually and how to once again burn with the fire of God in your life. In addition, you can also purchase the books, A Light in Darkness and No Room for Compromise. In one or both of these volumes, you'll step into the world of the New Testament as Rick Renner transports you to the ancient cities of the early church to hear what Jesus is still saying to us today. A Light in Darkness is available today for just $70, and No Room for Compromise is available for $55 while supplies last. Both volumes feature on-location photography with added artwork and illustrations to enhance the scriptural teaching that makes the New Testament come alive. Don't miss this special offer, Christ's Message to Laodicea and A Light in Darkness and No Room for Compromise while supplies last. Call the number on your screen now or go to Renner.org to order. Call or go online now.
My name is Joel Renner, coming to you from Moscow, Russia. And I want to say thank you to all of our ministry partners. Your support is helping us train people for the ministry. Getting an education is so vital. A good education can help people throughout their lives. Think about your own education and how it has helped you in your life. Well, Bible school training is no exception. This kind of an education is a vital tool for those called to serve God in various aspects of ministry. Because of the support of our generous partners, we are able to train and graduate so many students from our Bible Training Center in Moscow. This advanced training has been made possible by the support of our partners. Not only do they graduate, but they go off to make an impact for the gospel. These graduates have started churches, become missionaries, and are teaching, evangelizing, and working in the health ministry in many countries around the world, all because of your support. But there is so much more to do. In the coming years, our training center outreach will produce even greater results with a far-reaching impact, and we need your help. Will you consider joining us as a partner so that we can continue training men and women in our Bible Training Center? The vision you are supporting is the spreading of the gospel around the world. Right from your home, right now, you can help us help others by becoming partners in the work and supporting our work financially. Please call or go online to Renner.org. Because of your gift of any size, we can continue to make a huge difference in people's lives.
Thank you for letting me be with you today. Today we've seen in Revelation chapter 3, verse 14, that Jesus is the Amen. He is the final word on every subject. And tomorrow we're going to begin to see what the Amen had to say to the church of the Laodiceans. Don't miss it because it is powerful. But we're offering you my series, which is called Christ's Message to Laodicea. It comes with a marvelous study guide. Both of these together are just powerful. And we're also offering you my book, A Light in Darkness, and the companion book, A No Room for Compromise. You can order one, you can order the other, or you can order both, but go online or call us right now to place your order. These are real treasures. And for those who become partners, we always send you a special package of books as our way of saying, welcome to the partner family. But let me pray for you. My friend, Jesus has the final word in your life. He is the Amen. And Father, I thank you today that Jesus has the final word about family, the final word about sickness, the final word about finances. Jesus, you have the final word about every issue that we're facing in our life. We thank you. We are not bound by circumstances, but we live by you, the final Amen. What you say is what will be true concerning us. We thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for being with me today. Tomorrow we're going to be back. We're going to start in verse 15. But until then, remember Ecclesiastes 8:4, where the word of a king is, there is power.